Thank you very much for the welcome. I'm really very happy to be here today with you. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Roberto Dillon. I am actually originally from Italy, but I've been living in Singapore for more than 11 years by now. I moved there to do R&D in serious games. Then I started teaching. I was the game design department chair at DigiPen. Then I moved, and now I am associate professor in James Cook University, where I teach different game design and development topics. I wrote also a few books on game design, development, and the history of games. And at the same time, a few years ago, I also started my own indie development studio focusing on mobile games. We do games in-house, but we also collaborate with different companies. We have collaboration in Japan, in Singapore, and in Europe as well. So today, what I want to talk to you about is about our latest game. And I hope that this talk will be of particular interest to all the young and aspiring developers, indie developers who want to start out and see how they can maximize their chances of success. The game that, last game that we developed was called Robin Hood Give and Take. And this was released in November, late November last year. We released it on different platforms as browser games and then also on different app stores and marketplaces on iOS and Android, both on Google Play and Amazon. So the idea of this game is to have a kind of game focusing, especially focusing for kids, maybe around age 10. It's a stealth platformer where the player plays as a young Robin Hood who has to go around the castles of the bad guys of the Sheriff of Nottingham and steal gold and then give the gold back to the poor people in the villages, taking, based on the motto Robin Hood, that we take from the wicked and give to the worthy. I will go through a little bit all the process that we did for developing the game, starting from its inspiration. Its first prototype, which wasn't about Robin Hood, but as the title of this talk suggests, was about Santa Claus and Christmas. Then a little bit about the development and also the different performance that we got across different marketplaces. So the inspiration for this game actually was not related to Robin Hood. I started working on this about 2.5 years ago, and the idea was that I wanted to make a game for kids about Christmas. And it should have been a game with just simple gameplay, kind of a bite-sized gameplay to be played in 4 sessions as a mobile or web game, with completely no violence. And the idea was that really even losing the game, and the game was, as Robin Hood, a kind of stealth platformer, so being discovered by the other characters in the game, would still be kind of cheerful and can kind of bring a smile in the young players. These games, I had some references for these games. I am a retro gamer, I love old games. And for these games, I wanted to have a kind of art style reminiscent of an old game like one we see on the left, which was Little Computer People from Activision. But I wanted it to be a kind of stealth gameplay, a bit like the old Mission Impossible games, the games on the old 8-bit machines. So you had to run around, check some items and places, and avoid robots that you couldn't really fight against. You can just have to avoid them and try to outsmart them. Now, for this game, which was called Secret Santa, it's a stealthy Christmas, it was an HTML5 game, and essentially, I did it with completely zero budget. It was just my time. Did it in a couple of weeks, developed a very simple development. And for it, I used only 3 assets that you could find online from different websites, both for the graphics and also for the Christmas carols that I had to play during the game. So it's something that anyone could have done it with really just some of your time and no budget at all. All items were available for free. The game launched first as a browser game on a portal called dotclay.io. It was a kind of soft launch. It didn't do any kind of advertising. But the game fared relatively well. It got, during the Christmas season, got about 50,000 plays. Then I also did a port to Android and iOS, where the game is free downloadable and playable. And it didn't get much success, very little downloads, just a few downloads on Android and iOS. But anyway, it still managed to raise some interest from the press. There was a post-mortem published by GameSource and so on, and reviews were generally favorable. At the same time, then, I also started going around to different events like this one, and I started talking with publisher, and my idea was, let's see if any publisher could be interested in taking some of my games to the next level or having some more ideas. I had a few games that I was proposing that we developed, and in a way, I thought that the Secret Santa game, which came with a completely freeware artwork and so on, was possibly the least interesting one, but instead was the one that actually got some traction. And I saw that different publishers were actually more keen in something similar. In particular, Spiel Games, which is a well-known HTML5 and web games publisher in Holland, was very keen to have a similar game on their own portals and game sites. But they didn't want it to be a seasonal game. They wanted it to be more general, so not just Santa Claus, but something that you could play any day of the year. And it could have been easier to just reskin the game as a simple kind of haste type of game where the player is a thief that goes into different places and steal items and then go out trying to remain undetected. But I really didn't want to make a game about a bad guy. So remember, my original idea for these games was to have a kind of bite-sized gameplay with no violence at all, and where even losing should still be, if possible, kind of fun. So that was a bit of a problem, because I wanted still to make the game about a good guy, not about a bad guy. And I thought a lot about how can I make a game that is not about Santa Claus, Father Christmas, but still about a good guy. And then finally I got a good idea, which was to make a game about Robin Hood. So Robin Hood, we know that the guy in the Middle Age, England, who had to go around and he stole gold from the bad rich people and then passed it, redistributed it to the poor villagers and the good people. So he's still a positive character, even though he steals something from people who got rich at the expense of the poor guys. And the idea, Spiel Games were very keen about this idea. They liked it. So they bought exclusive rights for the browser version of the game. And this then allowed me to expand the team and hire a couple of artists in Singapore to work on the game, to have a good team and a much nicer artwork that we had previously on the other games. For working, we worked as a remote team, and we just met on milestone delivery to discuss the progress and get feedback and see how to push things forward. The game overall, the HTML5 game, originally took about 2 months of work. This is how we work. We used tools like Trello that are very, very helpful in managing a team remotely. We could discuss any aspect, get quick feedback on the artwork, the web development, on the level design, and all these kind of things. And things really worked out pretty smoothly. So the game was launched in late November. Within a couple of weeks, we hit all the targets that we wanted on Google Play and the Amazon store, both the traditional one and the new underground store, which we will see as some interesting feedback and experience on that, and also iOS. It launched at a premium game with a starting price of $199, which then also allowed us to play with the sales and discount it. And it was, well, I would say, a good strategy. The game actually got some very interesting feedback. It got number one kids games in the ages 9-11, which was exactly our target market, in the iOS App Store. Got number one in two countries, one in Asia, in the Philippines, and one in Europe, Slovakia. And also a top 10 in several other countries, including major markets like Spain, Italy, and other European countries. On Google Play, it also fared relatively well in the bigger arcade games category. It got some good rankings in different countries, both in Asia and Europe as well. And it was also featured by some very important websites like Kotaku. So it's when we first did our sales, moving the price from $1.99 to $0.99, actually Kotaku featured it in their app of the deal of the day. So it was really very interesting and very nice kind of feature for us that we did not expect. Now, Amazon Underground, maybe you are familiar with this, is a new service that Amazon launched a few months ago. The idea, right now the service is available only in a few countries, so only players from US, UK, Germany, France, Spain, and Italy now have access to this, but they are kind of expanding it. And the idea is that it's a marketplace for premium games or freeware games, but they originally had ads on in-app purchases, but where instead they are offered completely for free, with no ads, no in-app purchases, and premium games downloadable for free, where developers are paid by the minute that the players play it. By my own estimates, I believe there are about 2,000 games overall on the marketplace, so it's still not as crowded as others. And okay, let's see. Okay, I cannot really discuss exact numbers for confidential reasons, but I can discuss with you the kind of trends and relative performance among the different marketplaces, which I think is kind of interesting. In terms of downloads, the Amazon Underground was actually much more effective, and clearly the other on Google Play and iOS things were premium downloads. So it's you expect when you put it for free on a different marketplace, downloads to go much higher. And indeed, I had 10 times more downloads on Amazon Underground than on Google Play and iOS. Revenue-wise, instead, things were different. Every download was monetized right away on the other stores, either at $1.99 or $0.99, while revenue on Underground wasn't as high, even though the downloads were much higher. And well, in a way, also the gameplay that is kind of short session maybe didn't help on this. But interestingly, what we are noticing now that these graphs refer to Amazon Underground. Even though the kind of downloads tends to fade away in a similar way with all the other app stores, then the kind of minutes played by players remained constant. So we have a much longer tail, and now the Amazon, the revenue from Amazon Underground is actually coming up and kind of getting also closer to the one of the other app store, or the other sub stores. So that's very interesting. You can get, if players remain engaged, they keep playing it for longer time, and you keep monetizing them little by little. Now, regarding Amazon Underground, I would say that the pros were for us were to gain additional exposure, and as I was saying, the revenue has a longer tail, and it was, and I believe it's a very good platform for those games that required player to really spend some time. So puzzle games, hidden object games, I think they will be very profitable on this marketplace. While the kind of games that maybe can just play in very small sessions and then they require not much time, even if they are engaging, might not be that that suitable for this. Also could be very good for the kind of older premium games that maybe need a new relaunch and find new people. On the other side, on the downside, I realized that many players don't really kind of play it after they download it. This kind of upset me at the beginning, but then I realized that sometimes I also do the same. I find the game looks interesting, I download it, and then maybe I forget about it and I don't play it. So I cannot really be too picky about that. In conclusions, I want to stress the fact that even if the mobile landscape is extremely crowded and competitive nowadays, it's still possible then to get kind of profitable and get to an even number one ranking in some countries in different categories if you do things in a certain way. But it's very important that we find our own small niche. Kids games is an interesting niche, and also premium games fit very well this niche because the different marketplaces put a lot of constraints that you need to match to release your game on this kind of app store. So in terms of ads, of links to outside on the web, there are many small troublesome things that we can avoid it for a premium game. So it's also very important to do networking and look for publishers and the collaborators and events like this, so do the most out of it. And also try, if possible, to use some recognizable character from the public domain, from mythology, folk tales, and everything. That's really very important. That gives you a hook that even if you are a small company, then and people may not recognize the name of the company, we recognize the character. So I am very sure that if the game was not about Robin Hood, but I call it, I don't know, Robbie the Kid, Kotaku would have not featured it as the app deal of the day. But being a game about Robin Hood, everyone recognized it, knew what it was about, and this really helped a lot. Also, if you have kind of zero, very limited marketing budget, having a game based on a popular, well-known character, it's really can help a lot on this side. So, well, this was the kind of lessons that I wanted to share with you today. Please feel free to get in touch with me later if you have any questions or want to know more about what we are doing. Then I'm more than happy to share everything that I know with you. Thank you.